वेलकम टू बबल बुक क्लब। हाय एवरीवन, दिस इज मी बुलबुल। आई एम अ राइटर एंड अ ब्लॉगर। टू नो मोर अबाउट मी एंड माय वर्क, यू कैन चेक आउट माय ब्लॉग एट bubble.in। टुडे वी आर डिस्कसिंग एन इम्पॉर्टेंट पीस ऑफ वर्क फ्रॉम अमेरिकन लिटरेचर, दैट इज एडवेंचर्स ऑफ हकलबेरी फिन, written by Mark Twain, whose real name was Samuel Langhorne Clemens. Interestingly, he got his nom de plume from the leadsman call for two fathoms while working as a river pilot on the Mississippi River. Therefore, all the detailed descriptions of rivers and sunsets in the book have been drawn from the author's personal experiences in his life. Adventures of Huckleberry Finn was published in 1884, and the story takes place some 40 years back in the fictional town of St. Petersburg, which is based on the author's birthplace, Hannibal, Missouri. The book tells the journey of Huckleberry Finn, a teenage boy, and a runaway slave, Jim, floating on the Mississippi River, both running for their freedom. It deals with the themes of racism, slavery, morality, and depicts racist American society of that time, probably too clearly for the Americans to digest. And that's why the book has managed to get in trouble over and over again over centuries. It continues to be one of the most challenged books in the USA till date. The book got under scrutiny right after it was published in 1884 and got banned for its coarse language in 1885 by Concord Library. More recently, it got into trouble when in 2011, New South published a sanitized version of the book, replacing the racial slurs. Famously, Hemingway once said for the book, and I quote, "It is the best book we have had. All American writing comes from that. There was nothing before. There has been nothing as good since." Well, I don't know if he was right or not, but we sure can't deny the fact that America as a nation is deeply shaped by its racial history and continues to be affected by it in the present also. Funnily enough, the book starts with a warning. It is probably the only novel till date which prohibits its readers to find any plot in it. Right at the beginning of the book, the author gives a notice saying, and I quote, "Persons attempting to find a motive in this narrative will be prosecuted. Persons attempting to find a moral in it will be banished. Persons attempting to find a plot in it will be shot." Considering the book's involvement in controversies, I say Mark Twain was right in warning us. The book is narrated by Huck, who was the sidekick of Tom in the first book, Adventures of Tom Sawyer, which is the prequel to this one. But I read Huckleberry Finn without reading Tom Sawyer, and it didn't stop me in any way to enjoy it. And frankly, after reading about Tom's character in this one, I'm not much inclined to read the first one. Huckleberry Finn takes off from the point after both Huck and Tom are rich with their $6,000 and have invested their fortune with Judge Thatcher, earning a dollar per day, which is a good amount for them. Huck has been adopted by Widow Douglas, who lives with Mrs. Watson, and these two ladies try their level best to civilize Huck. But of course, Huck doesn't enjoy it at all, and he is unable to see the point of certain things, like when Widow Douglas teaches him about Moses. He says, "Pretty soon I wanted to smoke and asked the widow to let me, but she wouldn't. She said it was a mean practice and wasn't clean, and I must try not to do it anymore. That is just the way with some people. They get down on a thing when they don't know nothing about it." Here she was bothering about Moses, which was no kin to her and no use to anybody, being gone, you see, yet finding a power of fault with me for doing a thing that had some good in it. Fair enough. Out of boredom, he joins Tom gangs and expects it to be fun, but ends up disappointed from Tom's made-up fake stories. He says, "I got an old tin lamp and an iron ring and went out in the woods and rubbed till I sweat like an Indian, calculating to build a palace and sell it, but it wasn't no use. None of the genies come. So then I judged that all the stuff was only just one of Tom's war's lies. I reckoned he believed it in the Arabs and the elephants, but as for me, I think different. It had all the marks of a Sunday school." In the meantime, his pap arrives and takes him to a cabin. Huck, afraid of his father's drunken ways, devises a well-laid plan of his own fake murder and escapes to Jackson Island to hide, and there he meets Jim, who is a runaway slave of Mrs. Watson, and people think that he is the one who murdered Huck. Huck and Jim, both running for their freedom, develop a bond and encounter several people on their journey, giving them the adventure of a lifetime. This story is more than a story of a boy looking for fun. It touches upon many serious themes and manages to address them with a vigor. I couldn't help but root for the bond between Jim and Huck, and also for their victorious freedom after every difficulty that they face. It didn't take long for me before I found myself caring for a character as rough as Huck. The central theme in the book is slavery and freedom. Huck lives in a society in which slavery is normal. People keep slaves and consider them their property to buy and sell as they like, which when read now sounds appalling. But you can't blame the book for depicting the shameful history. Both Huck and Jim in the book want to be free and are running away for the same. In one of the instances, Huck tells us that Jim talked out loud all the time while I was talking to myself. He was saying how the first thing he would do when he got to a free state, he would go to saving up money and never spend a single cent. And when he got enough, he would buy his wife, which was owned on a farm close to where Miss Watson lived. And then they would both work to buy the two children. And if their master wouldn't sell them, they would get an abolitionist to go and steal them. This clearly shows how much is Jim willing to risk to be free and reunited with his family. And Huck, even though isn't a slave like Jim, he's running from the society which he doesn't find worth living in. Thus, even at the end, he says, "I got to light out for the territory ahead of the rest, because Aunt Sally's, she's going to adopt me and civilize me, and I can't stand it. I've been there before." And even though Negro slavery came to an end in USA in 1865 after the 13th Amendment, the freeing of slaves did not mean the end of racism. Which brings us to another striking theme of the book, which is racism. Mark Twain has been accused of using racist language, and the accusation seems to stick because of Huck's frequent and apparently unthinking use of racial slurs. The book in itself records more than 200 times uses of the infamous N-word. The whole book is littered with numerous dialogues, which also depicts the racist nature of the society of that time in America. In one of the instances, Aunt Sally asks Huck, "Good gracious, anybody hurt?" "No'm, killed a nigger." "Well, it's lucky, because sometimes people do get hurt." Unquote. It is appalling to see that people of that time didn't consider African American as humans. They were seen as mere objects. But to be honest, we can't hate the book or call the author as racist for honestly capturing the situation and not quoting the bitter parts. The use of racist language by even the sympathetic characters like Huck when he says, and I quote, "I knowed he was white inside, and I reckoned he would say what he did say. So it was all right now. And I told Tom I was going for a doctor." Unquote. Or when the doctor says, and I quote, I never see a nigger that was better nurse or faithfuler, and yet he was risking his freedom to do it. And unquote. All this suggests that society had internalized the colorism, discrimination, and slavery, and even the most objectionable terms were a part of their daily vocabulary. And thus, even if it is a shameful history, we can't run away from it just by banning a book or changing its text. This book is a reminder for us all of what needs to be changed. Moving on to Huck's journey with Jim, which has far-reaching impact on Huck's morality. Critics have referred to Huckleberry Finn, and rightly, as a novel of education, recording the moral growth of Huck. His moral growth takes the form of his emancipation from inherited prejudices relating to slavery, which is heavily dependent on his realization of Jim's essential humanity. His first decision is made very early when he promises not to tell on Jim. He says, "People will call me a low-down abolitionist and despise me for keeping mum, but that don't make no difference. I ain't going to tell, and I ain't going back there anyways. So now, let's know all about it." Huck's decision to humble before Jim for playing a prank on him is a momentous step in his spiritual progress. Huck is truly repentant when he says, "It was 15 minutes before I could work myself up to go and humble I myself to a nigger, but I done it, and I wasn't ever sorry for it afterwards neither. I didn't do him no more mean tricks, and I wouldn't have done the one if I had known it would make him feel that way." Afterwards, when Huck and Jim near Cairo, Jim starts getting excited for his freedom. This fills Huck with dread, for it draws upon him that he is conniving at the escape of a slave, and he says, "I got to feeling so mean and so miserable. I most wished I was dead. I fidgeted up and down the raft, abusing myself to myself, and Jim was fidgeting up and down past me. We neither of us could keep still. Every time he danced around and says, 'That's Cairo,' it went through me like a shot, and I thought if it was a Cairo, I reckoned I would die of miserableness." Huck's final struggle with his conscience is more intense because the punishment for helping Jim escape is going to hell. But he says, "It was a close place. I took it up and held it in my hand. I was trembling because I had got to decide forever betwixt two things, and I knowed it. I studied a minute, sort of holding my breath, and then says to myself, 'All right then, I'll go to hell,' and tore it up." Once again, Huck's innate goodness triumphs over the mores of this slave-holding society he has internalized. Huckleberry Finn is filled with motifs and symbols, and the most important of them being the Mississippi River and the raft. The river contrasts with the lot of wild and pettiness that Huck finds on land, and the raft represents freedom. Several times in the book, Huck says that there is no place like this raft. Both Huck and Jim seems to have found home on the raft. Apart from the serious themes and discussions, what strikes the readers at first is the language of the narration of the book. Author gives an explanatory note right at the start, claiming that the shadings have not been done in a haphazard fashion or by guesswork, but painstakingly and with the trustworthy guidance and support of personal familiarity with the several forms of speech. In this book, a number of dialects are used: the Missouri Negro dialect, the extremist form of the backwoods southwestern dialect, the ordinary Pike Country dialect, and four modified varieties of this last. By the use of these varied dialects, I feel, enriched the whole reading experience for me. It made it more authentic and real. So, this brings this discussion to a wrap. I would once again say that all the thoughts and the views said in this video are my own, and you don't have to agree with them. And I also would love to hear your views on the book. please comment them in the section below. And if you like the video, consider liking and subscribing for more. If you are a reader and want to read one book every month, join me in the club. All you have to do is join my mailing list and find me on Instagram @ASIswriting. Now you can also hone your writing skills with my monthly newsletter, which consists of hand-curated writing resources for writers. Come, start your writing journey with me.